Thank you. Hey, good morning, everybody. Hope you're doing well today. Just want to make a couple of announcements. First of all, if you'll remember, Brother Connor here, I believe he's having surgery tomorrow. Am I right on that, Connor? It's tomorrow, and so we need to be in prayer for him. Also, remember Monty Jennings. Monty had open heart surgery. I believe he had a triple bypass. Am I right on that, Aaron? A triple bypass? Quadruple bypass, okay. Quadruple bypass on Friday. And so just remember, Monty, anybody that's been around, anybody that's had open heart surgery, there's a whole lot of pain at the very beginning, and it's a whole lot of discomfort. And so just be in prayer for Monty. Monty's one of those guys like many of you. He just likes to be active. He likes to be out doing stuff. And right now he's been cooped up in a hospital all week and then had the surgery on Friday. And so he's got a recovery. So pray for him. Pray for Robin today. And of course, Aaron, we lift up you and Bryson as well and your family. I know y'all absorb this as well. But let's do this today. Let's be reminded today that Jesus is Lord. If you agree with that, say amen. Hey, we got something exciting coming up. Gary Habermas is going to be with us. I'll say more about this at the end. But let's be in prayer for Gary as he comes on August the 1st. Gary is an apologetics extraordinaire, and we're just excited about him being with us. It's a great treat for us. Thank you so much for being here today. I want to go to our prayer focus here for a moment, and let's be lifting up, of course, you know, several things, you know, in our prayer focus today. First of all, Deacon of the Month again. Robert, I know you are tired of having your name called, but you have to be Deacon of the Month all month, all right? So we're going to be praying for you and Tammy and Grant. Appreciate your family so much, and y'all have been such a blessing to us. Also, let's remember Emmy Bullen. Emmy has had pancreatitis, and she's been in a lot of pain, and so we want to remember Emmy. Emmy, I know you're probably watching this morning, and I just want you to know that we love you and that we are praying for you, and we just so want to see God touch you and God heal you and God, of course, bring your pain to a complete halt. And so let's remember that. And also let's remember Will and Rebel Hill in Japan. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. And how many of you today, you got something on your heart, not necessarily to mention, but some, you got something on your heart today that you need God to intervene? Anybody like that today? Just by an upraised hand. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and let's ask him to do just that. Lord, you're so good to us. And Lord, we just thank you so much for your goodness. God, we just pray that you would bless today. Lord, thank you for our visitors that are with us today. Lord, I pray that you'd bless them for being here. God, today I do ask that you would just be with Monty, be with Robin today. I know that Monty's in a lot of pain. And God, I pray that you would just touch him. I pray that you would just comfort him today. I pray, Lord, today that you just heal his body, a quick recovery today. And Lord, we're counting on that. Lord, today also be with Emmy. God, I just think of her and I think of, Lord, just the pain that she's been in for the last several weeks. Lord, I just pray that as our church reaches out to her, ministers to her, that, Lord, she would feel your grace and, Lord, just feel our love. Lord, be with Connor. God, I pray that tomorrow the doctors would have wisdom. Lord, that you would conduct that surgery. God, I pray that you as the great physician, Lord, that you would heal Connor. God, I know he's had this struggle for a long time. Lord, I still believe, Lord, that you're able to touch, that you're able to heal, that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above anything that we could think or ask. Lord, today be with the Hills in Japan. God, I pray that you'd bless them. Thank you for Robert and his family. Lord, continue, Lord, to use them, Lord, in their leadership. And Lord, I do pray that today as we come together in your name, God, that you would be exalted, you would be glorified, and Lord, we'd be drawn closer to you. Lord, we ask these things always in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
Good morning, Peace Haven. If you would stand with us today as we fix our eyes on the Lord our God who is mighty in battle. You know, this morning, we're going to read from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, and the scriptures are full of examples where God fights the battle for his people. And here in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, we see King Jehoshaphat, and he's the great-great-great-grandson of King David. And he's the king of Judah, and they come up against a situation that they feel like is impossible, an impossible situation. They're going into a battle that they know that they can't win on their own. And maybe you feel like that this morning. Pastor John just had people raise their hand if there's something on your heart that that you feel like maybe is an impossible situation. I want you to pay attention this morning to the strategy that King Jehoshaphat employs as he faces the impossible. Let's read it together. After this, the Moabites and Ammonites, together with some of the Mennonites, came to fight against Jehoshaphat. People came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast number from beyond the Dead Sea and from Edom has come to fight against you. They are already in Hazazon Tamar, that is, in Gedi." Jehoshaphat was afraid, and he resolved to seek the Lord. Then he proclaimed a fast for all Judah, who gathered to seek the Lord. They even came from all the cities of Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah in Jerusalem in the Lord's temple before the new courtyard. He said, "Lord, God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? Power and might are in your hand, and no one can stand against you. Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel, and who gave it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in the land and have built you a sanctuary in it for your name, and have said, if disaster comes on us, sword or judgment, pestilence or famine, we will stand before this temple and before you, for your name is in this temple. We will cry out to you because of our distress, and you will hear and deliver. Now, here are the Ammonites, the Moabites, and the inhabitants of Mount Seir. You did not let Israel invade them when Israel came out of the land of Egypt, but Israel turned away from them and did not destroy them. Look how they repay us by becoming to drive us out of your possession that you gave us as an inheritance. Our God, will you not judge them? For we are powerless before this vast number that comes to fight against us. We do not know what to do, but we look to you. All Judah was standing before the Lord with their dependents, their wives, and their children. In the middle of the congregation, the Spirit of the Lord came on Jahaziel, son of Zechariah, son of Benaniah, son of Jael, son of Mattaniah, a Levite from Asaph's descendants. And he said, listen carefully, all Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and King Jehoshaphat. This is what the Lord says. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast number, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, go down against them. You will see them coming up from the ascent of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the valley facing the wilderness of Jeruel. You do not have to fight this battle. Position yourselves, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord. He is with you, Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid or discouraged. Tomorrow, go out to face them, for the Lord is with you. Then Jehoshaphat knelt low with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell down before the Lord to worship him. Then the Levites from the sons of the Kohathites and the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel, shouting loudly. This is God's word. And so this morning, church, what we realize is that Jehoshaphat did exactly what we need to do. He learned something from his great-great-great-grandfather, King David. He knew that the battle was not theirs, but that it belonged to God. And so trusting and depending on God when we're facing impossible situations is the strategy, because the battle belongs to him. So this morning, let's lift our voices and let's praise him, because we know that the battle is his.
Oh, God, the battle begins. earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice.
Oh.
great job, worship team. Thank y'all so much for that. If you will, go ahead and take out your Bible. If you'll turn to 1 Samuel chapter 16 and 17. 1 Samuel chapter 16 and 17. While they're getting the pulpit in place, Jeff Dinkins had asked me to announce that he is so grateful for all the cards that the church sent him a couple weeks ago. And so, Jeff, we love you, man. Appreciate you. And, of course, you know, we as a church just want to stay behind you. Every week, you know, we have somebody to come up as a prayer focus. The reason we do that is because we want a lot of these people, they don't say anything. They're not going to say anything to you, but we know kind of what's going on in their lives. So, Jeff, our prayers are always with you, man. We love you. Appreciate you. And I hope that you'll send Emmy a card this week. Make sure that you send her a card and that you just absolutely positively let her know that you are a church that loves her. She has a church family that loves her, and we are behind her as well. And so many others, too. It's so good to see Regina with us last Sunday. I didn't see her until she came in. Is she here this morning? I don't think she's here, but she was here. Oh, there she is right there. Okay, Regina, good to see you here today, and we're grateful. What is this, Sylvia, for y'all? Is today pack a pew? Is that what you're doing today? You got your whole pew packed back there? But it's good to see you. Appreciate you. By the way, visitors, thank y'all so much for being here today, and we do have a special gift for you back here at our visitor center right after the service. So if you will, if you'll make your way back there after the service, and we want to make sure that we take a moment to just bless you today in the name of Jesus. We've been talking about vocation, location. That's our GPS. We're looking at our giftedness, we're looking at our passions, and we're looking at our story. Last week we started with our supernatural gifts that we were given at salvation according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Romans chapter 12, Ephesians chapter 4. And also we looked last week at our natural giftedness. You were born with natural gifts, natural traits, things that you're just naturally good at. Every good gift, James chapter 1, verse 17 says, every good gift and every perfect gift or every talent, those natural gifts is from above, which cometh down with from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, no shadow of turning. And so you have supernatural gifts and you have natural gifts. And we looked at David's natural giftedness last week. We saw how he's good at slinging a rock. We saw how he was good at playing a harp. God had given him musical gifts. God had given him somewhat of a military gift. And then, of course, on top of that, we looked at how that David was able, even in the power of God, that the Spirit of God came on him. The moment he was anointed king, the Spirit of God came upon him, and our Bible says it never left, or he never left. I shouldn't say it. Sometimes we'll refer to the Holy Spirit as an it. It's not an it. It's a him. He is the third member of the Godhead. And so today we rejoice in the fact that he lives within us, that he, of course, takes possession of us. He indwells us. He baptizes us into the body of Christ, and he continues to fill us as we ourselves submit to him. But I want to look today not just at our giftedness, although we looked at that last week, and hopefully you have discovered, hopefully you have kind of delved into your own life. You've been somewhat introspective, and you said, okay, here's my natural giftedness. Now, what about my supernatural giftedness? Now, some of you may say, Pastor John, I really don't even know how to discover that. I don't understand how to look at 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans 12 and Ephesians 6 and understand what my spiritual giftedness is. If that's the case in your life, please give us a call because we can help you with that. We do have things that you can do to kind of help determine that, but we don't want you to limit yourself just to those gifts. You know, as you discover your spiritual gifts, sometimes we think to ourselves, well, that's my gift, so that's all I'm going to do. Don't do that. Leave yourself open because you never know what God will do in your life. You never know how God is going to gift you in your life. You never know how God is going to motivate you and how he's going to position you for a greater purpose. But today as we look at our passions, I want to start off with a quote by Augustine. And Augustine said this, and it's interesting. He said, men go abroad to wonder at the heights of mountains. He said, go abroad at the huge waves of the sea, at the long courses of the rivers, at the vast compass of the ocean, at the circular motions of the stars. And watch this. This is what he says. He said, as they're doing that, they pass that by themselves without wondering. Now, again, here's what he is saying. He is saying, you know, men travel all over the place. And they'll go to high mountains. They'll go to great depths into the valleys. They will go to great rivers and great oceans. And they will, with great admiration, they will take in those scenes. And I've done it myself. I've been to the Grand Canyon. And we went to the Grand Teton last year. We were looking up and seeing amazing things. We were looking down and seeing amazing things. However, what Augustine is saying here, he is saying that don't bypass what's right there in front of you. Last week, we took our scripture reading from Psalm 139:14, and our Bible says this, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and I'm wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. What Augustine was saying, or Augustine, and the reason I keep saying this is because people pronounce it different ways, and so I'm trying to accommodate all of you. But what Augustine was saying is, he is saying this. He is saying, sure, go to the mountains. Sure, go to the valleys. Go to the Grand Canyon. Go to the Rockies. Go to the Alps. Go to the Himalayas. Go to all these places and enjoy that scenery. However, don't do so without seeing one of the most marvelous works that God has ever put together. And ladies and gentlemen, that is us. As we consider the words of Psalm 139 in conjunction with the injunction from St. Augustine, we realize that although the heavens declare the glory of God, and although the firmament demonstrates His handiwork from Psalm 19, verse 1, we need to look no further than the human body, and we need to look no further than the human conscience to at least conclude that there is an intelligent designer. Now, we're going to go further than that, but that's a good place to start. It's just to look at your body, how it's fearfully and wonderfully made, and then come to the understanding and the obvious conclusion that there is an intelligent designer somewhere out there, but more so a designer with much more care and much more purpose. Both Psalm 14:1 and Psalm 53:1 say this: the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. God there is translated from the Hebrew Elohim. Elohim is the same word for God that is used in Genesis chapter 1 when the Bible describes God as our creator. And it's Genesis chapter 2, as the creation of man is recapitulated, it says it's Jehovah Elohim. Elohim is the creating name of God. And yet our Bible tells us this: the fool has said in his heart, there is no Elohim. Or the fool has said in his heart, there is no God, no creating God, no intelligent designer, no creating one. And here's why we're foolish when we do that. It's because when we look to the heavens and we see the glory of God, we look to the firmament, we see the glory of God, and we look to our bodies and we see the glory of God, there is no way to look at all of that intelligently and come away believing there is none other than Jesus Christ or God Himself who created it. And the reason I say Jesus Christ is because John 1:1 throws Jesus into the mix. The Trinity was involved: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all involved in creation. And so, ladies and gentlemen, today, can we just start off with that? Understanding Psalm 139 to be this: we have a Creator, and we are fearfully and wonderfully made by that Creator, not just to exist, but to have a great purpose and to fulfill that purpose. Just as a note of interest, the Hebrew word palal, that is translated wonderful. We talk about it being wonderfully made. Psalm 139 in verse 6 and in verse 14, palal, the Hebrew word, is rooted in the same word used in Proverbs chapter 30, verses 18 and 19, to describe three and actually four things that we see all the time, but we cannot fully comprehend. Look what Proverbs tells us. The Bible says this. The Bible says, there are three things which are too wonderful for me, yea, four which I do not understand. And he says this: the way of an eagle in the air, the way of a serpent on the rock, the way of a ship in the midst of the sea, and then the way of a man with the maiden or with the virgin. Now, some translations use the word amazing for wonderful. Means basically the same thing. The idea is that the eagle in the sky, the snake on the rock, the ship in the sea, the man with the woman is in essence too amazing to grasp. The flight of an eagle for someone living in the Old Testament biblical times was incomprehensible. Now, it's still to a degree today. As I see an eagle fly, it is incomprehensible to me. But just think about how incomprehensible it was back then. I mean, the technological discoveries of aerodynamics, as we understand them today, was thousands of years in the future. I still cannot comprehend how an 850,000-pound 747 jumbo jet can fly. But how many of y'all been on one? I don't understand that. Right speed, right combustion, right airflow. It's so amazing to watch tons of steel drifting. Here's what I find to be incredible. I mean, I've been on one of these things. I've seen these things. I know how they're made. And yet it blows my mind that you can go to an airport and watch these things float down like a feather. I still don't understand that, but I don't understand aerodynamics. But that's kind of what the Bible's talking about here. The Bible is talking about here about things that we cannot comprehend. The eagle itself, what an incredible, incredible, incredible thing. Scientists today still marvel at how a snake slithers forward on a smooth surface. I mean, scientists are looking at this thing and they're thinking to themselves, you know, how does this happen? I mean, the fullness of even snake mechanics is still a mystery. How does everything in that snake move together in perfect precision? It's amazing, and that's after the curse on the snake. Who knows what the snake was like prior to? We know, we believe it stood up in some way. Hey, as far as ships go, we see the eagle. It's amazing. It's wonderful. It's incredible. We see the snake as it moves. By the way, I know most of you women and probably most of you men don't care how the snake moves. You just don't want it moving toward you. Is there any truth to that? But then there's the ship. You know, as far as ships go, the Nimitz class USS George H.W. Bush. I have a picture of it here for you. But man, that thing, I was reading about this thing this week. It's incredible how this thing even floats on the water. It is some 100,000 tons with over 4 acres, I believe it's 4.5 acres of just flight deck. It is 20 stories high and carries more than 3,000 soldiers, and somehow it floats. How in the world does this aircraft carrier measuring over 1,000 feet in distance float? And then, and I don't want to elaborate on this, but our Bible alludes to it. I'm just going to allude to it. And you know, as adults, we understand this, you know. But the Bible says, bring that back up. As an eagle, we don't understand that. It's incomprehensible. As a snake slithering on the rock, incomprehensible. We don't know how it works. God put it together. As a ship sail, and even a man with a woman. I don't have to elaborate, but you understand, God is putting things together that are just too wonderful to comprehend. The eagle, the snake, the ship, all too amazing. All too wonderful to comprehend. But God says that you, as a creation, as we consider these things, the eagle, the snake, the ship, the man, God says this in Psalm 139. He says, you as a creation by his hand and from his heart are too wonderful to comprehend. And so I'm saying that today so that you will look to yourselves, because many of you, you may not think much of yourself. You may not think of yourself as a creation of God. You might not think of yourself as a person that has great value, that God has created with great purpose. That is the whole purpose of this GPS study, is that we understand every person in here is naturally and supernaturally gifted. If you're a believer, you are supernaturally gifted. Number two, God is going to give you some passions in your life for you to act upon. And then number three, God is going to give you a story. We'll talk about your story next week, but it will include two things. Number one, your blessings. Number two, your brokenness. Everybody in here, you have a story of blessing and you have a story of breaking. And that story culminates together, and when it comes to full fruition, it adds up together into what God wants to weave together in a beautiful tapestry that will help fulfill your purpose. And so don't discard that. I know many of you, you know, just kind of live this week and you don't realize how wonderful and how incomprehensible that you are as a person. Don't miss the glory of God in you, and do not miss the purpose of God in you. We are aspiring throughout this study to discern, to develop, and to deploy our gifts as an effort in exercising our vocation location. We want to know, what does God want us to do? We discussed last week that David had both natural, again, and supernatural giftedness from God. You know, as New Testament believers, again, according to James 1:17, we too possess a natural giftedness, every good gift and every perfect gift. But once again, keep in mind, as we jump into our passions, let's remember 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, Ephesians chapter 4. That also reveals our supernatural giftedness. So, let's look at this. Today, as we consider our wonderful and our amazing constitution, both physically and supernaturally, spiritually, let's examine our passions. Now you say, Pastor John, what is a passion? You have to know what a passion is to understand what your passion is. Here's what a passion is, and this is, as easy as I can describe it. A passion is that thing that you live for. It's that thing that you get up for. It's that thing, you know, that awakens something inside of you. A passion is that thing you live for. It captures your thoughts. It captivates your soul. It is that which fully awakens your heart. It's what mobilizes your body. It is the source of your motivation. Today, every person in here, I want you to think about something just for a moment, okay? What is your passion? What awakens your soul? For example, if you're just kind of laying around and doing nothing, what would bring you to action immediately? What passion would get you out of your seat and get you going? Now again, some of it's just going to be natural stuff. As we work through this, though, we need to be able to develop and understand not just our natural passions, although the natural passion can be used in the supernatural, but we have to understand, you know, first of all, what is a passion? It's that which fully awakens your heart. It's what excites you at the very center of your values, at the very center of your vision for your life, at the very center of your motivation is your passion. Here is what we find to be sad among believers. Many of us have allowed ourselves to be more consumed with non-spiritual passions and even unspiritual passions than with spiritual passions. Now, are we going to have non-spiritual passions? Nothing wrong with having a non-spiritual passion. There's something wrong with having an unspiritual passion, but nothing wrong with a non-spiritual passion. But today, my challenge for you is this. My challenge for you today is simply this. It's that you would discover a spiritual passion that trumps all other passions, and that you would act upon that very thing. What awakens your heart? What moves you to action? Do you have to be begged and prodded by the pastor to engage spiritually? And by the way, you know, that's a tough thing. I mean, honestly, I've been pastoring, senior pastoring, lead pastoring since I was 29. Before that, I was associate pastor, youth pastor, assistant pastor, all kinds of pastor. But at 29, I became a lead pastor. I've been doing that. Now I'm 51 years old. My biggest challenge is motivating people in the spiritual realm without making them mad. That's my biggest challenge. I have a responsibility and an obligation before God to lead this church to a place where every person in this church is motivated to love God with all their heart, with all their soul, and all their mind. And to be honest with you, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered something. I can't do it. It's got to come from within you. I can stand up here. I can stand on my head. I can do a cartwheel, or at least I used to be able to. I'm not going to try it today. But I've done all of these things just to try to get people motivated and to try to get people to read their Bible regularly, not as a ritual, but to hear from God, to sing from their heart, to have joy unspeakable, full of glory, peace that passes all understanding. And ladies and gentlemen, it is discouraging sometimes, because as I look around at the church, not just our church, but I look around at the church, it just seems that people are less and less spiritually engaged, and that their passions point more toward the non-spiritual and even to the unspiritual as opposed to the spiritual. And if there's any hope for this world, if there's any hope for the future of the church, ladies and gentlemen, right now there is a party. Politically speaking, and I don't get political much, but I have my eyes wide open. There is a party that is putting the party before the country, and they want to take over the country so that they can push unspiritual values on this country, including murdering babies, including same-sex unions, all of those things that are anti-godly, anti-biblical. And ladies and gentlemen, today, don't be that person that is out there saying, well, I sure hope somebody does something. How about we as the church do something by, first of all, becoming spiritual people? And today, if you're a Democrat, or if you're a Republican, if you're a Libertarian, you know, just get off of all that. How about this? How about we just come together and be a Christian? Let's forget about political parties, because there's corruption in all of them. Washington, D.C. is not the answer. The church is the answer. But until we become passionate about something that is spiritual, making a difference, snatching souls from hell, bringing Jesus to this culture, we're going to continue to see it get darker and darker and darker. I ask you today to consider this. Become a self-feeder. What that means is this. It means that you don't rely on Pastor John or Pastor Jared or any spiritual leader in this church, male or female, that you're not relying on them for your spiritual growth, that you yourself have gotten in the Word yourself and you said, Lord, feed me, speak to me, and Lord, give me a passion for what breaks your heart. If you become a self-feeder from God's Word, the Holy Spirit will fill you with a certain passion, and it will involve the cause of Christ. Hey, if you wish to truly arrive at your spiritual vocation, after you've acknowledged your natural and supernatural gifts, consider that passion. What is it? David had a natural gift. He could sling a rock. David had a natural gift. He could play an instrument. And you know, and he honed those gifts, man. I mean, he worked at that. But as we alluded to last week, David was a man after God's own heart. We see this in 1 Samuel chapter 13. I didn't have it for you last week, so I'm going to give it to you now. This is the goal. The goal is for God's people to be people after God's own heart. And you see that alluded to in 1 Samuel 13, 14, and directly stated in Acts chapter 13, verse 22. Write those verses down because you're going to need those verses. That is the goal. We want to have a heart for God, men and women after God's own heart. We also learn from Acts chapter 13 that David served his generation by the will of God in his gifts, but also out of a passion for God. And we see that passion here in 1 Samuel 17. I want you to read the account with me, okay? I'm going to read it very quickly, but 1 Samuel chapter 17, read with me where we find David's passion. Remember David's giftedness? We found it in chapter 16 and 17. Now let's look and see if we can discover David's passion. I know you know the story, but let's read it anyway. Now the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle and were gathered at Socah, which belongs to Judah. They encamped between Socah and Azekah in Ephes-Damim. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together, and they camped in the valley of Elah. Now, just to give you the setting, you remember who Saul is. Saul is the king of Israel. He's the people's choice from the tribe of Benjamin. He's the wrong choice. He's from the wrong tribe. But the Bible says, Saul and the men of Israel were camped together, and they encamped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side with a valley between them. Now, here's where we get to, the punch of the story. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He was over 9 feet tall. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had a bronze armor on his legs and bronze javelin between his shoulders. Now the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels, and a shield bearer or an armor bearer went before him. Now listen to this. He stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, remember the Philistines are the enemy, and the Israelites are here. The Israelites are over here on one mountain, the Philistines are on the other mountain. There's a valley between them, the valley of Elah. And here comes Goliath, and look what he says. He stood and he cried out to the armies of Israel and he said to them, why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves. Let him come down to me, and if he's able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us. So it's a very simple thing. Here's what happens. Goliath says, you send out a man. I'm coming down. You send out a man. And if your man defeats me, we'll serve you. If I defeat you, you serve us. Save a lot of bloodshed. We'll get this thing over with quick. So he says, choose a man. If he's able to fight with me and kill me, we'll be your servants. If I prevail against him and kill him, you shall be our servants and serve us. And the Philistines said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistines, they were dismayed and they were greatly afraid. Now, I got to remind you of something. You remember Saul himself is head and shoulders taller than everybody else. So the obvious choice, even though he pales in comparison to the size of Goliath, relatively speaking, he's still very small. He's like a dwarf. However, he is the most obvious choice because he is the biggest man in all of Israel. And yet, he is greatly afraid. And I just want to say this to our leaders today. If you're a leader today and you get afraid, here's what's going to happen. The people that follow you are going to get afraid. Be men and women of faith. David was the son of that Ephrathite of Bethlehem, the Bible says in verse 12. Judah, whose name was Jesse, who had 8 sons. And the man was old, advanced in years in the days of Saul. The 3 oldest sons of Jesse had gone to follow Saul to battle. The names of these 3 sons who went to the battle were Eliab, the firstborn, Abinadab, the second, and the third was Shammah. David was the youngest, and the 3 oldest followed Saul. But David occasionally went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem, and the Philistine drew near and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. Then Jesse said to his son David, David doesn't know what's going on. Jesse doesn't know what's going on. But he says, take for your brothers an ephah of this dried grain and these 10 loaves and run to your brothers at the camp. Carry these 10 cheeses to the captain of their thousand and see how your brothers fare and bring back news of them. Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. So David rose early in the morning. He left the sheep with the keeper. He took the things and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the camp, and as the army was going out to fight and shouting for the battle, for Israel and the Philistines had drawn up in battle array, army against army, and David left his supplies in the hand of the supply keeper, ran to the army, and came and greeted his brothers. Then, as he talked with them, there was a champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name. coming up from the armies of the Philistines, and he spoke according to the same words. So David heard them. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him. They were dreadfully afraid. So the men of Israel said, "Have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. And it shall be that the man who kills him will be enriched with great riches. Saul's going to give you his daughter and give his father's house exemption from taxes." Hey, that's a good deal right there. Hey, if you go out, any Israelite that goes out and fights this Goliath, number one, you get to marry the king's daughter. Number two, you don't have to pay taxes for the rest of your life. And so, you know, that's kind of sweetening the deal just a little bit. But David says this in verse 26. David said to the men who stood by him, "What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him in this manner, saying, "So shall it be done for the man who kills him." Now, here comes some cold water. Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David, and he said, "Why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle." And David said, "What have I now done?" He said, "Is there not a cause?" Or in other words, just asking a question. "Eliab, I just came down here asking a question." Now, I know it's a bit of a lengthy reading, But I want us to get the full context. I want us to kind of grasp the atmosphere and the surroundings of what's going on in the story. As we encounter this account, David's passions become more and more obvious. The standout passion in 1 Samuel 17 is that David, and I don't know if you're catching this, David is the only person in the whole account from God's people that even bothers to mention God's name. Did you catch that? The only other person that ever mentions God's name in the whole account is Saul, when he's sending David down into the battle and he just flippantly says, "The Lord be with you." He's thinking in his mind, this boy is going down there and he's going to be slaughtered. Here is what's happening in David's life. Remember, his gift. His gift is that he can sling a rock. His gift is that he can play a harp. His spiritual giftedness is that the Spirit of God has come upon him the moment that he was anointed, and that Spirit stayed upon him from then on, never taken away. Even in Psalm 51, after David is confessing his great sin, he begs God and says, "Please don't take your Holy Spirit from me," and God did not. However, when we get here, these are God's people. Now remember, Goliath represents so many things. Goliath represents everything that we as a Christian culture are afraid of. I mentioned a while ago the politics now that are coming against the working against the tide of Christianity. There are politicians now that are opposed to us. There are people in our culture. Our whole culture is opposed to this thing called Christianity. And it's going to get worse. The closer that you walk with God and the more that you stand for what the Bible says, the harder the tide of this culture is going to work against you. And if you're not careful, you're going to become afraid. You're not going to want to be associated with this thing called Christianity. And yet, ladies and gentlemen, Christianity is the real thing and everything else is false by comparison. But we have become fearful. And what has happened in this culture, in the Valley of Elah, is God's people who are supposed to be trusting God, unfortunately, they have a leader that is fearful because he has turned his back on God. And since he's fearful, it's become contagious and it has rippled across the entire army to the point that nobody's talking about God and everybody's talking about Goliath. And if we're not careful as believers, what we're going to do is we're going to see the Goliaths of this world, and that's all we're going to talk about, is we're going to talk about how big Goliath is, how intimidating Goliath is, how powerful Goliath is, and we need somebody, some man, some woman that will stand up and say, "Goliath is powerful, but greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world." Is that true? And that's where David's passion is. And that's what needs to happen right here in every heart today. Is that you would say, "I don't care how big Goliath is. I don't care how powerful Goliath is. Whatever your Goliath may be." Right now, our Goliath is this culture. It's a godless culture that has swept across our country. And we say, "It's too big." It's not too big. He's bigger. "It's powerful." It's not too powerful. He's more powerful. Our passion today has to be that God is greater and that no matter how big the Goliaths are and how loud they shout or how loudly they shout, it doesn't matter. Here's all that matters. God is greater. And so David shows up on the scene and he stands out like a sore thumb. And here's why. Nobody's talking about God. Saul's not talking about how great God is. We sang a song today, "How Great Is Our God." You believe that? Well, they didn't. As soon as Goliath showed up, it was like, "How small is our God?" I'll tell you what, let's sing this together. How small is our God? Sing with me, how weak is our God? And all will sing, how little, how small is our God? Something about that don't sound right. Y'all weren't singing along. What happened? You don't believe it. You don't believe that, however, maybe you do. You're not going to say it. But if we're not careful, we're going to look around and we're going to become very sheepish and we're going to become very, very standoffish, even to the point of being paralyzed spiritually, because we look to the valley and we see the Goliath, and instead of our passion being, let's see what God can do, our passion is more, well, let's just, you know, become part of the culture. Let's not rock the boat. Hey, I'm not asking you to go out and pick a fight. The fight will come to you. You don't have to go to find it. But we have been called to be peculiar people. We have been called to be the light. We have been called to represent God. We are the ambassadors right now, and we have been called more than conquerors. And our Bible tells us that the victory has been given. Thanks be to God, which gives us the victory for our Lord Jesus Christ. This was David's passion. David's passion, number one, was to acknowledge God's existence, to proclaim God's preeminence and his supremacy. And then not only that, he took another step. He said, my passion is to talk about him, my passion is to represent him, and my passion is to prove him. Now that is where most people never go. We will acknowledge him, we will speak of him, but we will not position ourselves to prove him. And you know why we won't? Because we fear that maybe he won't come through. And I say to you today, God wants to show himself mighty. God is looking for a man and looking for a woman through whom he can show himself mighty. But that person has to be a person that shows up at the battle already prayed up and already shored up by their personal relationship with God in private. Private philosophy always determines public performance. Private philosophy will always determine public performance. Everybody wants to publicly come out good, but very few privately have put in the time. I was at the YMCA the other day, and one of our teenagers, I heard him say, "Pastor John." And I looked over, and it was that boy right there in the pink shirt. And I told him, I said, "Man," I said, "don't be jealous of these biceps." But it was obvious that he had put in the time. Because as I looked over, you know, his biceps were bulging and my bee stings were barely visible. And I was kidding around with him and I told him, I said, "Man," I said, "you know, don't be jealous." And he says, "I'll try not to be, you know." But it's obvious. In private, when nobody's watching, he's making it happen in the weight room. And that's going to determine what he does on the football field in public. Private philosophy always determines public performance. Now, that's true physically, but that's true spiritually, even more so. What's happening in your private time? You want to go out and win the battle and have a passion for the battle? David had a passion for the battle because God put it with him while he was watching the sheep. David had a passion for the battle because God had instilled within him, had implemented within him a heart that is after his own heart. So that when David got there, he didn't want to just talk about God. Nobody else was. He didn't want to just talk about God. David is saying, let's prove him. Let's put him to the test. Let's see what happens here. Next week we'll see how David's story actually factored into this as well. But you can see that David arrived casually on site. But here's what happened. When he got there, something captivated him. Something awakened his soul. Something awakened his spirit. You say, what was that? It was his passion for God. David saw the fear that Goliath imposed on all of the army. And David's passion was to dispel of that fear by bringing God into the equation. No one else seemed interested in capitalizing on this opportunity. And David says, well, if you won't, I will. Do you find it strange, again, that amongst God's people, nobody's talking about God? And ladies and gentlemen, today, unfortunately, in the church, it's normal for people not to discuss God. It's normal for people to be out and not to talk about God. It's normal for people when they get in a restaurant to look around and make sure nobody's watching so they can pray their prayer real quick so they won't be associated with Christianity. Every once in a while, you go out with an old boy or you go out with a woman and you ask her to pray and she'll pray and bless the food for 20 minutes out loud. And you say, what's wrong with that person? I'm thinking the same thing too because I just want to eat, you know. But listen, that person doesn't care because they realize these people around me need to hear that there's a God and that there are people. Not, don't do it as if you're doing it as a show, then leave it alone. It's not about a show. It's not about, hey, look at me. It's not about being condescending and arrogant and cocky. It's about being humble before God, but being vocal about his goodness and his greatness, his wonder. I believe this. You know, in marriages, I do a lot of marital counseling. And I don't consider myself to have the perfect marriage because my wife messes it up most of the time. But I don't consider myself to have the perfect marriage at all. I've learned a few things, and I share those few things, but I'm very honest and transparent about it. I tell people I'm not an expert, but I'll do what I can to help you. But here's what I am finding in a lot of marital counseling that I do. And it's what I am dubbing as this. I call it the silent divorce. The silent divorce. Because I see a lot of couples come in that are still married, but in their minds and in their hearts, they have divorced. Now, they don't use that term because, you know, Christians just don't use that term, you know. Well, it happens. Many of you have had to go through divorces, and so you understand the nastiness of it and the heartbreak of it. But a lot of times people will come in, and as they're sitting there, I'm thinking to myself, you've already divorced in your heart. You've already divorced in your mind. You're living together as though you're married, but the real truth is there is no passion whatsoever in this relationship. The thrill is gone. It's called, or what I'm calling, the silent divorce. Now, I say that, this is not a marital sermon today, but I'm going to draw it into where we are as believers. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a lot of us that have engaged in a silent divorce with God. We're in the pew or we're in the chair. We're saying the right things, hanging around the right people. We're keeping up the appearance. However, in our heart and in our mind and in our soul, the things that we're supposed to be worshiping God with, all of that, all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, ladies and gentlemen, we divorced Jesus a long time ago. We'll be in the pew, but we will not be passionate about Jesus. We'll show up, but we're not passionate about Jesus. We were at one time, but we're not anymore. What we have done is we have silently divorced Jesus and maybe not even knowing we've done it. Most marital couples, when they're sitting in my office, they don't know they've done it. They've silently divorced each other. They haven't filed for separation. They haven't gone to the courthouse. They haven't hired a lawyer. However, there's no passion whatsoever in their marriage. It's as if they're not even married at all. They're just in the same residence. Ladies and gentlemen, today, I'm sorry to say this, but it is so true. right here in our congregation and in other congregations of the like, it's full of people who have lost their thrill, they've lost their love, they've lost their passion for Jesus, and they're chasing after every unspiritual passion that's out there, or non-spiritual passion that's out there, and Jesus is just somewhere on the back burner. Saul, in our story, he has divorced God silently. As we look at Saul, Saul is the epitome of the silent divorce. There was a time when it seemed that he loved God. There was a time when God's Spirit was upon Saul. There was a time when God was using Saul. There was a time, you know, when Saul was even prophesying. But as we get to this story, when we get to this point, this is kind of a study in contrast, because we're looking at Saul, who has silently divorced God. You don't hear him denouncing God. Here's the thing. He's not defying or denying God. He's ignoring him. That's the silent divorce. The silent divorce is not that you are defying God. And it's not that you are denying God. You are just ignoring God. And most people, if not all of us right now, should be in our hearts repenting. Because we know it to be true. We know that the passion that we used to have, we know that the thrill that he used to bring us, it is no longer there. We are becoming more and more like Saul, to the point that we're going to show up in the right place, we're going to show up with the right people, but in honesty, we're not really talking about God. As soon as Goliath shows up, we are silent. And it's because that before in private, we divorced God, and so it's going to come out in public. When Goliath shows up, we will be fearful, and we will not be the person that goes down into the valley. And ladies and gentlemen, God has called us to more than that. God has called us to be passionate. You say, Pastor John, I've divorced God. I got good. He hadn't divorced you. You say, I've silently divorced God. Well, the good news is he has not divorced you. He will never leave you. You say, I'm not as passionate about God as I used to be. He's never lost his passion for you. That's the beauty in all this. Saul had never declared that he had disconnected from God. He had never declared a divorce from God. He just stopped speaking about him, stopped trusting him. He stopped speaking to God. And thus he stopped speaking about God. I have found this to be true. The people that are speaking to God can't help themselves. They have to speak about God. The more you speak to him, the more you're going to speak about him. This army, they didn't speak of God. You say, why didn't the army? Why didn't somebody in the army speak of God? Why would they? Their leader wouldn't speak. They'd been tainted. The fearfulness had been contagious. It had been passed down. It filtered down. Nobody wants to talk about God. Nobody wants to fight Goliath, because the person who's supposed to be qualified and overqualified, he won't even go down there. We're sure not going down there. However, when David got there, here's what awakened his heart. Goliath's blasphemy against the armies of God. And David said, whoa, 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 that's as far as we're going. Now here's my question to you today. And it's a question I've been asking myself all week. What in this life awakens your heart and brings your soul to life? What does it? Some people can't wait till spring so they can plant flowers. Some people can't wait till fall for hunting season. Some people can't wait for fall so they can watch football. There's certain things that awakens our spirit. And nothing wrong with those things in and of himself. But spiritually speaking, I ask you this question, and please answer it in yourself. Please answer this question. What, spiritually speaking, actually awakens your soul? Now, I do realize this. I'm talking to some people today. You're not even a believer. You have a form of godliness, but you have denied the power thereof. Nothing I'm saying today is resonating with you. Oh, I know about God and I believe in God. Yeah, but you're not a believer. You have not been transformed by the power of Christ. That's why right now none of this means anything to you. That's why right now this is just kind of a little talk, and you know, when it's over, you're going to walk out and be the same person. It's because that there's been no transformation truly in your heart and in your soul. I believe in God, Pastor John. So does Satan. A lot of people believe in God. It's not about believing in God. It's about believing in the death, burial, and resurrection, and about putting your faith and your trust solely in that. and then God's Spirit transforming you, and then things like this bother you because you think, I'm not passionate about God. The believer's going to want to be passionate about God. Yesterday, we had several of you that showed up. We had a great walk yesterday. I felt like the Love Life walk went well. And Pastor Jared did a great job leading worship yesterday and really preparing the hearts. So we're down in Greensboro. One thing that stands out to me, Carmen, is your passion for that ministry. Hannah, your passion for that ministry. But I tell you who really stands out. Isaiah stands out. His passion, Isaiah Berner. His passion for that ministry. I mean, when you're around Isaiah, you know, hey, he believes in this. Now, I'm going to say something right now that's going to shock you. Matter of fact, it's going to be disturbing for most of you. Matter of fact, most of you are probably just going to get up and walk out after I say it. I ain't passionate about it. I'm not. You say, Pastor John, you're not passionate about fighting this abortion fight? No, I'm not. By the way, neither are you, most of you. I'm not. I'm probably never going to be. Now, that does not mean that I won't show up, and that does not mean I will not stand, and that does not mean that I believe that it's right. I believe that it's wrong, and I'm going to stand against it. However, I'm not showing up every Saturday. Now you say, well, something's wrong with you. Something's wrong with you too, because most of you weren't there. You know why you didn't show up? You're not passionate about it. Now that's not necessarily wrong, because I have to be passionate about something spiritually. That's just not it. Now Isaiah, he's not passionate about what I'm passionate about, but he would stand with me on what I am passionate about. Let's just all understand this. God has given us different passions. He's given Carmen a passion. He's given Hannah a passion. And I believe he wants to give a lot of you that same passion. I'm not passionate about it. I can't make myself passionate about it. But I do know this. God has given me passions that are spiritually speaking as well, that other people aren't passionate about. That's why you got to find your passion. Now, does that mean, this is what I don't allow to happen. Just because I'm not passionate about it like Carmen and Hannah, and Sharon and others in our congregation, just because I'm not passionate about it doesn't mean I'm not going to show up. I'm going to show up because I need to be there. God's people need to be there. But there's going to be things I'm going to be more passionate about than that, because God hasn't given me that passion. So today I say this to you. You know, some of you may be looking around and you say, well, I'm just not passionate about this thing, and I'm not passionate about this thing. That's okay. As long as you find what you are passionate about that has God's name attached to it. And by the way, I do believe we need more people standing with Love Life, standing with Lifeline, standing with Compassion. And we do as a church, and I make sure that we throw as much money as we can at that and throw as many people as we can at that and encourage as many volunteers to do that, because it needs to be done. Little babies are being murdered. Little babies are being murdered. One woman caught my eye. I watched yesterday as they were taking her in. And I'll be honest with you, it's probably the first time that God has really just touched my heart about this. Because I saw that woman get out of her car, walk to one of those escorts, and as I was watching, my mind just wandered. I was watching and I was thinking, within that woman, as she is walking across that parking lot with that escort from the abortion clinic, she has a real live baby inside of her that God has fearfully and wonderfully made, and she's going in there and she's going to take its life. 22 babies yesterday were scheduled to be murdered in Greensboro, North Carolina. 22 babies that God created. We can't help but stand. Now you say, Pastor John, you know, I might be getting passionate about it right now. I don't know. Something might be happening. But I'm just saying, you know, y'all understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying, you understand what I mean by passionate, meaning that it's not my calling and it's not something I'm going to be doing all the time. That's what I'm talking about. There's something I need to be doing all the time. There's something you need to be doing all the time. And it might be that. But don't be that person that has no passion at all. Psalm 37:4 says this. It says this, and you know this verse. Delight yourself also in the Lord. He will give you the desires, the passions of your heart. You delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the passions of your heart. Now, if you misread that verse, you will say, oh, I'm going to delight myself in the Lord, and He'll give me everything I want. No, He will determine what you want. He will change what you want. He will give you a passion for what He wants you to do. And so that has to happen. Now, this is David writing as an older man. You know, later he says, I've been young, now I'm old, yet I haven't seen the righteous forsaken. So David reflects on his connection to God during his greatest battles, his worst defeats in Psalm chapter 34. Psalm 34. If you read verse 24 through 26, we're not going to, you'll see all that. But David reminds us, if we delight in God, He's going to give us the desires of our heart. He's going to change our desires to what it needs to be. Yesterday I mentioned Isaiah Berner, and I love Isaiah. He prayed in reference to the fight for unborn believers. Let me tell you what he prayed yesterday, because I wrote it down, because it so grabbed me. He said, Lord, tether this cause to our hearts, for we know it's tethered to yours. He said, Lord, tether this cause to our hearts, because we know it's tethered to yours. That prayer alone reveals a passion in Isaiah. I don't have that passion for that ministry, but I'll tell you one thing. I sure do like being around him, because he does. And again, God's given me mine. God's going to give you yours. Here's my question today. You say, well, Pastor John, I'm not passionate about fighting the fight against abortion. Okay. I just admit it. I'm not either. It's not my greatest passion. But if that's not the passion that God has put in you, then what has He put in you? What has He naturally and spiritually gifted you to do? Mark Walker contacted me yesterday. Mark's a friend of mine. We played softball together. And Mark, of course, is a former U.S. representative from North Carolina, and he's making a run for the Senate. He called me yesterday, and Mark, you know, basically said to me, you know, he wants to come and speak at our church. And I know it's a bit of a kind of a campaign thing, but Mark's a pretty good preacher. And so I've gotten to know him over the years and have appreciated him. You know, but I was thinking when we stopped corresponding, if you know Mark, if you know anything about Mark, Mark is passionate about what he does in the political realm. And I was just thinking, I've had people to tell me before that I need to run for office. And I prayed about it. I really did for about 30 seconds. I prayed about it. But that's not my passion either. See, what I'm saying is Carmen and Hannah and again Sharon and others that have been or are involved in pregnancy centers, that they're passionate about that. Mark is passionate about what he does. It's not for me. What's for me is this right here. This is what's for me. This is what I love doing. I love standing up and yelling at y'all. That's what I love to do. I love proclaiming the truth. I love preaching the word. I love to share the gospel. You know, I do. Now, what's your passion? Because we're looking at our GPS. Number one, what's your giftedness? What's God naturally gifted you in? Number two, what your spiritual giftedness is. We'll help you if you don't know that. But then we look at the second. What is your passion? David's passion was this. I have a passion to know God. I have a passion to be connected to God. And I have a passion to talk about God. And I have a passion to prove God. And David walks down in that valley with God all over him. And David passionately hurls that sling. It must have been something to see. David comes down there and David says, you come to me with those physical weapons, I come to you in the power of the name of the Lord God of Israel. Man, that must have been something to see. Had to sound like that, something like that, man. It's in that old forehead. God's guiding that rock. That old boy. I like what that old preacher said. He said, Goliath said in the Hebrew, he said, nothing like that's ever entered my mind before, you know. And that's kind of what happened. And bam, right on his face. David picks up that sword. He probably can't hardly even hurl it. And just probably look like a drunk man out there, and finally goes, he picks up that head, and in the Hebrew, he's na 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 na. Now, I imagine David wasn't too cocky, but he held that head up. And when he held that head up, man, the Philistines are rolling. Have you ever pictured this, though? The armies of Israel are attacking. I have to believe that there was one guy standing up on the hill, disgusted, and saying, that should have been me. Saul had to be so disgusted with himself because he knew there was no power. And I think many of you feel the same way. You see God using so many people in so many amazing ways, and you're thinking to yourself, I silently divorced him a long time ago. I have no thrill, and I have absolutely no passion for him. And because of that, I have no courage for him. And ladies and gentlemen, today, you're one decision away from saying, I'm done with this lifeless living. I'm done with this lack of passion. I am done with no thrill. I am, from this day forward, I am marching to the Valley of Elah, and I'm going in the power of God, and I will not be that person that silently divorces him. I'm going to reconnect with him. And in doing so, I'm going to feel him again. We had a lady the other night on Wednesday night. She came to me afterwards, and I so appreciated her sharing this with me. She came to me, and she said, Pastor John, she said, it's been years since I felt God. And she said, tonight, I've followed him, and I've lived for him, you know, but there's been some things missing. And she said, I felt him tonight. I've been wanting to feel him. And I ain't never seen anybody, she smiled so big her ears were wet. I mean, it's just a great, great thing. And so today, ladies and gentlemen, we have fallen asleep. We need to be awakened. What awakens your soul? How about letting God awaken your soul this morning? Our instrumentalists are coming, and as they come, ladies and gentlemen, prepare your heart right now and just say, Lord, I don't want to be Saul watching it go on and knowing it could have been me. I want to be David, down there, talking about God, living for God, living out my private philosophy, living it out in a public performance, not for personal gain, but that God himself can be proven and that the culture can be changed. David changed the culture immediately. The culture was fear. The culture was not speaking about God. And suddenly, it's all about God because one man said, I'm going to live out my passion. I love him. He loves me. He's proven himself to me. I'm going down in the valley and watch what God can do. And ladies and gentlemen, what can God do with you? You can change the culture in a moment just simply by living out your purpose. Our GPS, our gifts, our passions. What about your story? We'll talk about that next week. In the meantime, let's stand together. And would you right now just prepare your heart as we go to worship? Would you right now just bow your head, close your eyes, and say, Lord, some of you may just want to say, Lord, I want to. I've said that before to you. Lord, I want to. Lord, there's a desire in me to want to. Lord, right now I don't have the want to. How many of you right now, just by an upraised hand, you'd be honest enough to say, Pastor John, I need a want to. I need a want to. Just raise your hand. I need a want to. A want to. Well, if you want to, ask God to give you a want to. Delight yourself in the Lord. He'll give you the desires, the passions of your heart. He'll change them. So take a moment as Connor plays softly. Just take a moment. And would you just right now say, Lord, show me what my gift is. Show me what my gift is. And then, Lord, give me a passion for you, a passion for you. One that I've never had before. Make it so strong and obvious that I cannot deny it. Would you pray that? When you finished doing your business with God, lift up your voice, lift up your head. Let's sing this song together. Build my life.
And I will not be shaken.
if y'all will come. I believe we might have some closing announcements here. Miss Rebecca, if you'll come, and Pastor Jared, if you'll come as well.
Joe said I had to stand right here. That's right, Joe? Okay. Next week, we have our pre-K K Kids Church open, so make sure you have them here early and get them signed in and checked in. They're going to enjoy a special Sunday junior church or children's church. We're also opening up both children's church and junior church, what we used to call it, but now we're calling it the kids churches. We're opening them up on these three dates, August 8th, 15th, and 29th, and we will hand out schedules to let you know when we are opening them up every month. It'll be three times a month, and the other times they'll be in here with their kids' sermon notes and doing some family worship, and we'll explain more about that later. But we're excited about opening back up, being able to spread the good news to these kids and teaching them to stand on their own faith, and we're excited about that. Kids, if you did your sermon notes this morning, come see me and Miss Kathy down here. We've got some candy for you to be able to look at what you took notes on today. I love seeing this kind of thing. Also, Miss Stephanie, the next slide, we have a training for all. We're opening back up. We need to get together and meet. So all of you that are a lead teacher in our Sunday morning kids churches teams, we need you and all of our assistants to be at this luncheon on August the 1st from 12 to 2. We'll get you in and out, and we're going to have a great time together just getting back together and talking about what's new for the upcoming year.
All right, Pastor Drew.
Awesome, Miss Rebecca. Just a couple of things. For Launch Student Ministry, we are going to be taking a trip to Surge Trampoline Park on Wednesday, July the 28th from 5 to 9 p.m. The cost for that is going to be $10 plus money for food. So if you are 7th through 12th grade in here, put that on your calendar. We are going to have signups this Wednesday night, so make sure you're there at Launch Prep on Wednesday to sign up for that. We also just want to remind you that we are going to be doing worship team auditions on Monday, August the 2nd, like Brother Chuck talked about last week. We are looking for more than just musicians. We do have positions that we want to be able to fill back here at the soundboard, also at the lighting, and all the tech that's back there in the tech booth. So if you say, hey, I don't know how to do those things, but you're willing to be trained on it, please go by the Welcome Center desk, fill out a form, let us know what you're interested in, what you may be passionate about, and we can help train you in those areas. If you can play an instrument or you love to sing and you're not already currently involved in our music ministry, then we would love to have you audition. And that sounds maybe sounds daunting, but it's not really supposed to be all that daunting. We just want to know if there are people out there that have talents that they're not using. So this gives you an on-ramp to be able to get involved in our music ministry. Go by, pick up a form, and fill that out. For our D group leaders and hosts, I just want to invite you to put August the 8th, that's Sunday, August the 8th, on your calendar. We're going to do a cookout for all the D group leaders and hosts at 5:30 on August the 8th at my mom and dad's house, John and Jenny Hoots' house. So make sure you put that on your calendar. I'll send out an email soon about that. And I think that's everything I got.
All right. Again, thank y'all so much for being here. Visitors, thank y'all so much for being here. Lindsay, great to have you. Thank you so much for being here. It's great to meet you today and others that are here. Misha, good to have you. I see you brought that old ugly guy with you today, but you're still hanging out with him, I guess. So great to see y'all today. Appreciate that so much. Dylan, you don't be jealous back there, okay? I know you've been admiring these biceps this whole service, so you don't be jealous back there. Y'all pray for Dylan back there. All right, visitors, please go back to the welcome desk. We have a special gift for you. Thank y'all again so much for being here today. It's a privilege to have you. If we can help you in any way, please come see us. God bless you. You are sent.